What's up, Madden 17 fans? My name is Cody, and I want to welcome you to today's Madden 17 video. Today, what we're going to be doing is basically just I'm going to get on the mic, I'm going to play a game, and we're just going to share a little bit about my scheme, things that I'm doing, and hopefully what will happen is you'll be able to glean a couple principles that will help you guys. Not because I'm the best, but just because everybody plays a little different. I'm going to try to share what I've been doing, so hopefully it's helpful. While we're waiting, I want to quickly talk a little bit about the Madden Bowl. Dang it, he conceded the game. All right, we'll just jump into another one. While this stuff is happening, I want to quickly talk about the Madden Bowl or the Madden Challenge or whatever you want to call it a little bit more. I talked a little bit about it in my last video. But what we've seen here in the Madden Bowl and something that I think is really kind of important for us to realize is that schematics shift a little bit throughout the season. And so what you'll see is that a lot of times people will start in the beginning of the year with one scheme, and then by the end of the year they've actually changed the entire thing up. Spot Me Please did this, and I think it's actually kind of important to hit on it. He went 0-3 in the group stage. Now what he did was he came into the challenge series with a completely new, not really new, but kind of multiple offenses. And so what he did was he, in the first Madden Challenge or Madden Bowl, when he won the whole thing, he ran predominantly bunch weak and bunch tight end. And actually, probably majority was bunch tight end. That was pretty much what he ran, okay? When we came into the group stage for this round, what Spot Me Please was doing was he was going into all kinds of different formations. He was going to ace pair twins. He was going to split close. He ran a little bit of the, he still ran a little bunch tight end and a little bit of bunch, but he was also using a bunch of different formations. Occasionally used some of the doubles, the doubles flex, just different types of formations on his offensive side. On the defensive side, he pretty much stayed the same. Ran the dollar, 3-2-6, the cross man, and just executed. Now, what I'm about to say, I think, is probably one of the most important pieces of advice I could give anyone. And I think we learn it as you watch these players, especially at the top levels. Knowledge is not the issue. Execution is the issue. There's a quote that basically says, if information was the solution, we would all be geniuses and have six-pack abs. What he's saying is, we know what we're supposed to do. The problem is in the doing, the art of executing. That is really the hardest thing because there's no magic formula for it. You can't really systematize it because pressure and all these things have come into play, the intangibles. It's like when people try to predict how rookies will do, most people can't really tell. Like, the same person that said Peyton Manning was going to be a Hall of Famer also said Ryan Leaf was going to be a first round Hall of Famer, first ballot out of college. You just don't know, okay? You just don't know. There's no real way to prove it. And so for me, the primary issue is execution, okay? I believe that it is imperative and important and essential to have your game plan of plays be as small as possible. And so you break it down to the, and you whittle it down to the core of what it is. And what you'll come to find is a lot of times these plays, you got to whittle it down to like purpose. And so for me, if you watch me play, I run probably 6 to 7, maybe 4. It just depends on the game. But for the most part, I run like 6 plays. Okay. And they all serve a purpose, that they literally have a very intricate piece. I say that there's only 2 types of plays. There's a power play and a counter play, and that's really it. Some people think there's more, but you have access to so many plays in Madden. And what happens is people get so caught up in the entirety of the play call sheet, and so what they'll do is they'll try to confuse people by going to multiple sets. The problem with that, and Tom Landry did this, the Dallas Cowboys head coach, for a long time, he did this. He would have a multiplicity of formations and shifts and changes. And the funny part about Landry was he was actually a better defensive coach than an offensive coach. Now, the interesting part of that is on defense, he pretty much ran the same defense. He ran the flex 4-3. Everybody does their job, gets in their gaps, fills the lanes. Much better of a defensive coach than an offensive coach. Now, Lombardi, probably better on the offensive side than on the defensive side. Lombardi's playbook consisted of the power sweep, the inside trap, and the play action pass and a quick slant. Like, that was pretty much it. Now, there was a couple of other things that they did, but by and large, that was their offense. I'm suggesting to you that to take a lesson from those guys and all the players really that play Madden, what you'll find is that's that kind of truism lasts across, because you can only call one play at a time, okay? You can only call one play at a time, and even more so, your opponent chooses what he's going to call based off of your tendencies. So, like, for example, especially on the offensive side, so, like, he's running this PA zone across, everybody runs that play, that should have been interception, everybody runs that play out of this formation, okay? So, if he only went to this formation one time throughout the game, I would pretty much key on that play right there. That would be the play that I really kind of tried to stop, okay? Because that's the most popular play. Now, when he comes out, he throws in bench, and he throws in PA zone across, and he throws in a halfback draw, and different things like that that deepen this formation. It makes it harder for me as a defensive player to stop him, okay? You can't live in the highlight reel. Okay, you have to kind of mix it up, but you've got to mix it up in within the formation. Like here, there's a couple things that happen from this formation right here. Screen is one of them. The quick flat pass to the running back is another one. You're probably going to get verticals. You might get a C route, and you might get a quick in route from the running back. Like, that's pretty much what people are going to do from this formation. Okay, all of those plays really boil down to they're going to throw the ball quick to the outside or up the seams. That's where most of those routes are going to target. So I just set my defense up for those two things, and I got you, because there's nothing, you don't have that counter. What people do is they run power from 17 formations, and they never get to the counter because they can't, because everybody, when they're looking through the playbook, they want to call the best play. The best play is the right play, okay? There's no perfect play. There's only perfect execution. Execution is the game, okay? That was a good play call right there. That was interesting. I've never seen that before. And he gets a touchdown out of it, but that's okay. Like, he'll come back out. And over the course of the game, you get multiple shots to stop it. When the chips are down, people are always going to do what they are going to revert to what they are comfortable with. And so, for me, I would rather just be there the whole time. Because to me, master power counter, and you do that by whittling it down, simplifying your playbook so that you only have to master a couple things. Because if I make the right read on every play, I'm going to win the game. The key is to limit my mistakes. And still, while still being able to move the ball consistently, right? That is the key to anything you do. Is you establish one thing, and then you're able to counter it with something else. And if you watch the players with the best offenses, they really are not running a whole lot of plays. Hollywood is kind of someone that kind of really played well. I think he went undefeated in his group stage. What he was doing was he was running PA seams, and he was running the verticals, or he was checking down to the running back out of the backfield. That was pretty much what he ran. I mean, that was pretty much like that's pretty much it. I mean, I watched the game with him in problem. I didn't see a whole lot of variance, right? I mean, he ran PA zone and seams a few times, but by and large, it was PA seams for the majority of the game. And the reason I'm saying that is not because I think that there's some type of genius in that. What I'm saying is I think it gets to the point of what we all really need to focus on. That was a stupid play. Stupid play call. It's cover three. I can't. Dang it. Stupid. So to me, it's about leverage too. Attacking certain points of the field, trying to figure out where do you have leverage on every play is kind of important to me. Not everybody thinks the same way. But like what will happen is they're going to use her. A good player is going to use her cover well, okay? If they're good, they're also going to probably have some kind of blitz that they're going to use, okay? So they're normally what people will do is they'll use her over the middle and they'll try to cover the outsides with different types of coverages. Your job as a play caller and really what I would say a play designer is to find routes that work well together within throughout plays and also accomplish what you want to accomplish. What I want to accomplish is I want to be able to attack different areas of the field, okay? Not necessarily a money play. I just want to be able to attack different levels of the field. That should have been a catch. That's ridiculous. And I want to be able to make it simple enough that I can have the right read. So one thing that I do is I have, I also have in my playbook these things called constraint plays. And that's where, like, if he's giving me the same thing over and over again, I can pretty much guarantee he's going to call cover three. I have a play that's really going to do really well against the cover three. Just a quick little throw like that. To me, that's a really good constraint play because what it does is it's a quick hit and you really can't do a whole lot about it if you're in cover three. Except you can use it. I mean, you can try to user defend it. But most of the time, it's going to be a very difficult thing to stop. And then there's the halfback base. Again, that's a power run play, right? But in the grand scheme of things, it's actually kind of a constraint play when you think about it. We're going to use this as an opportunity to set this formation up here. Want him here. Tim Brown, Cole Beasley, there we go. All right, so defensively, we needed to do a little bit better job. Offensively, I think we did okay. Trying to think here. We had a couple misreads, which is on us. We got to be able to be smoother. A lot of it, to me, is your transitions. Like as you're playing, being able to shift from read number one to read number two to read number three, that's a really difficult thing. But I think if you can get that down, it makes it simpler. And so I try to use timing. Like, all right, one, I want to look here. On second, two, I want to be looking here. Those kind of things. And I think that helps a little bit. It may not be the key, but I think it helps a little bit. Trying to have everything timed out. That's something that Bill Walsh tried to do for Montana. Was like the steps of his feet was where he should be looking. So everything was timed. Kind of almost like a science. All right, let's see what we can do here. So here's doubles. You got a quick flat to the running back or a screen. There's the quick flat. Nice throw. Okay, so he went kind of like a... Need to make sure we're getting that hot route out. Let's see, doubles again. You got the quick flat to the right. See, there's that quick flat. And that's what normally... I was surprised he hit that backside in route. I was surprised I was able to get open against the defense we called. What's supposed to happen is that guy's supposed to let him go. So here we go, backside, quick left flat. Watch the tight ends up the seams. There we go. Crossing route. Let's see what the... We're going to change it up here. Little corner route. Good throw. That's just a mismatch. Nitschke can't really cover him there. One thing I'm kind of messing around with is a cover two kind of man hybrid. see if I can show it to you right here. So what we do, cross man, everybody's cross man, you got the flats, he goes right to a screen pass. That's so annoying. I feel like you like set up an expert defense and he just goes to a screen pass. We'll see how that works. I don't know how good it will work, but it seems like it could work. See if we can, we're gonna try it again, I think. So we're gonna use this situation. We wanna be in cover four. Right there. I was right there. Daggone it. Wasn't able to get my guys manned up, unfortunately. Good run. I think that this guy is going to be a good guy to test that two-man defense out. What it does really well is it gets that those crossing underneath patterns, like you've seen, like he was running those in routes. I think it will do a good job at that. And then also being able to take away like the quick flats, like out of that, when he like that throw to the running back, stuff like that. I'm trying to find something that the cover two and the cover three defenses that I use don't really take away. And to me, it's the crossing routes. I don't really do a great job at the crossing routes. So we're gonna try that defense out to see if we can combine it to be able to take those away. All right, so he's kind of seen what I do. Once they start seeing it, normally what will happen, especially if they're a good player, is they'll adjust to it. And they will try to stop certain routes. That's what most people do. This is normally a great counter to my power play, in my opinion, because it just does a lot of different things. That it basically everything breaks outside instead of breaking inside now. So I think it's a really good changeup. But normally where we want to be is we want to be in the PA post. I mean, that's the bread and butter. I've actually kind of changed my trajectory how I kind of read it. That was stupid. I could have easily went out of bounds there. That was so stupid of me. Dang it. Because I've thrown too many interceptions on the quick throw to the left side. So what I've started doing is looking for a quick throw up the seams to the tight end, especially with like how many people will normally get sucked down trying to stop that quick route. I'm a little trouble with my hot routes here. So this is easy pickings. When you go backed off coverage, that normally means cover four. So what I like to do in that situation is I'll throw a constraint play, especially in this situation. And he goes into cover two. We'll check it down. I need to take that running back and put him on a seam route instead of a block and release pattern. Yeah, because what I think this will do a decent job of, something like this, and we have a little levels concept on that right side. I have to look to the running back there quicker. Because he was wide open there. So that's something where, like, you have to, especially with your constraint theory plays, which are your plays that you kind of just throw at him in certain situations of the game. What I'm finding is normally, this guy's doing a good job. I'm not really thinking about the pressure component that he's going to bring. What a play. What a play. He's able to hold us to three. That corner made a really good play on that ball. Not too big of a deal. I'm pretty sure we get the ball at half, so we'll be okay. I tried to change it up a little too much on that drive. I should have stuck with the PA post. He was having a lot of trouble stopping it. That's what we want right there. Make the tight end return it. So 35 seconds. This is another thing. So it's like you got 35 seconds, three timeouts. So a couple things that he's probably going to do. Number one, a lot of people will try to get it. They will try to make a big play, especially with the time that they have. So what that means to me is probably going to run a screen or some type of real, like, try and make a big time play. I'm okay with giving up a crossing route like that if he's willing to take that. To me, what I would rather try to take away is the deep middle and the deep sideline. If I can take those away, I think we'll be okay. So what I'm going to do that is I'm going to use the nickel. Try and get it. There's the seams. Oh shoot, I totally failed. Epic fail right there. Dang it, got excited. There we go, sidelines covered. That's a check it down. There we go. All right, we'll see what he does now. Didn't get my defense set. Probably got a little excited. I shouldn't have gone into the nickel. That's again, we're like, that plays good, but I just, it was too early to switch out of the, that was just a bad play by me. Dang it. Frustrating though, because that was an easy stop. I should have been able to get that. If I would have just stayed, because I came out 4-3 under there, and I had my Tampa 2 and was just taking away everything big. Let that go in the end zone. We'll take it out of the back of the end zone. Everybody's on Jackson here. We're just going to run it right out of the end zone. I've fumbled way too many times on special teams. Like, it should not be that easy for the game to shift. All right, so it looks like he may be in this cover two style for a while. So the goal here defensively, or offensively here, is just to get a touchdown, be simple, nothing too crazy. Looks like he's gonna start going across, man. That's wide open. And see, if he wants to take that away, if you guys watch, that tight end's wide open up the seam. So I've got to really kind of hone in on that Mike backer. Try and play a little chess with him. There he is, wide open up the seam. See, what I'm finding is more people run cross man and all that stuff. It leaves that quick throw up the seam open. And to me, that's the real bread and butter of this little levels play that we run, is that seam pass, that quick up the seam little quick hit. Oh, wow. Big sack there. What most people will try to do is they'll try to get everything back in one little play. We're gonna try and just hit a, oh, that's not good. Dang it. Gosh, all we had to do right there is just freaking cut to the outside. See what we can get here. Beautiful. think that puts us in field goal range. See what we can do here. 4th and 5. I feel pretty confident in PA post to be able to get me a first down. We're going to try and risk it here. What a play. Covered a lot of ground there. Really surprised that he was able to get there. Probably had the easy check down, and I just thought I could squeeze that in. There was a sack. So there's strong flits. He didn't take that quick check down to the back, because that was wide open there. 2nd and long here. This is where I kind of want to test the waters a little bit here. See what they had. Him coming out in snugs kind of changes things a little bit. All right, so what we're going to call here is cover 2. There's a slant. There's the post route. We got 14 people there. Should be an easy bat. Draw 4th down. That means he's going to have to punt here. Okay. Defense did his job. Offense got to go down and score now. Had a little trouble with the mic. Okay, so right here. So 4th down. So we got the ball back. I score. Dang it. We've got about 4 minutes left in the game. So that's what I'm trying to think is, like, how much time do we have to really get a stop next time we come through? Z spot was, like, wide open last time. So kind of want to try to give it another hit. Quick pass. There we go. I think I'm going to change that play up just a smidge. Running a lot of cover 3. Feel kind of confident in my ability here to hit this route to Cole Beasley on the constraint throw. There it is, wide open. Wow, what a gosh dang. He's making some really athletic plays out there. That 29, I think he made the interception too. I mean, Dak on it. When they crowd the line of scrimmage like this, it makes it a little bit difficult, like on your reads, who to go to. Because you don't really know what, I mean, it's a good disguising tactic. I mean, it makes it very difficult to figure out where do you want to attack. What I would say that we probably have not done a great job of is attacking that deep sideline. I have a couple plays that can do that fairly well. Let's see what we can do here. There we go. Doing a good job on defense, because what he's doing is he's forcing us to take the check down. He's just saying, backing everybody up. He's like, I'll give you 5 to 10, but that's it, you know. There he goes to hard flat. We're able to easily see that, check out, go to the C route. There he tries to be a user on that. And oh, Matt Stafford just barely misses a touchdown. Dang it. That's kind of frustrating. Need that touchdown. try a zig over here to Clark. Bring up a 3rd and 6. Trying to think through here what options we got in a 4th down situation if that comes. We're going to run PA post here, bread and butter. Play calling gets kind of simple once you start getting down in these nitty-gritty times because you know you're going your bread and butter. Question is, can he stop it? And there's wide open Tim Brown. See if we can't catch him up in a no-huddle situation here. Make him burn a timeout. Should have our twins set up here. So basically what we're talking now is tying up the game, but then the real hard part is going to be getting that stop. We're going to try and run power O here. Normally that's my bread and butter on the goal line, able to get in. But now the key is stopping. We have enough time left on the clock though, like 2:53, we have 3 timeouts left, so that helps us out a little bit. It's going to give us time to be able to make adjustments and try to get a stop. See if we can get these kicks down. Had some trouble with these kicks. Dang it, I was hoping to get it. It's hard to angle those. I'm not really good at it yet. I saw a guy do it against me, and it was really, really effective trying to kind of skim it past you. So defensively here, this is kind of where you need to make your stop. I mean, this is where you really got to lock in. If we hold him to 3, it's really not that big of a deal, in my opinion. I think we'll be okay. But giving up 7... Oh, no. Gosh, I can't get any freaking adjustments in. Pick. Intercepted. Tyron Matthew. So there he goes to that corner route. He went to that before earlier on in the game, was able to complete it for a pretty good gain. I think we had went hard flat that time. We're sitting in our Tampa 2, able to take that corner route away. And so now we got him. Now we kind of got the upper hand here. This is where you got to play mistake-free football. I mean, this is, you got to put a drive together, you know, pretty simple. But it's a lot more, probably a little bit more protective, I would say, than normal. But again, you've got to play a little loose. You can't confine everything. But what he's doing a lot of, he's done it pretty much all game, is run cover 3. That's been his go-to. Switches there to cross to cover 0. We're able to get a pretty good play there by Cole Beasley. We'll take that to the 2-minute warning. So coming out of the line here with 2 timeouts, a couple things. So we've got 3 timeouts. We'll also have the lead. That's a big deal. When you have 3 timeouts plus the lead, and then if we can get him with no timeouts, that's a big, big deal. So what you're going to see from me is trying to, number one thing is to keep the ball in bounds. It's okay if we score a touchdown, but what we really don't want to have happen is to score a field goal. And of course we run out of bounds. Dang it. Hit him late in the flat on accident. Big run by Derrick Henry there. Now he's going to have to take a timeout. He doesn't take the timeout. We're going to take it all the way down. So this is where tendencies and all that really come to fruition. In this situation, because if he gets a stop here, he's in pretty good shape, because we kind of have to take the field goal because of the time left on the clock and all of that stuff. If we can get the first down here with a little push from Derrick Henry, that's going to be huge. He ends up going offsides. We'll be able to take that and get that first down. Now, to me, in this situation, it's just very simple. It's 3 runs, no passes, to take that clock all the way down. He's going to go ahead and concede, so kind of admitting that we were going to get that W. So pretty good game, I think. Pretty good game to teach and watch from. We were very simple, made a couple mistakes on offense, but overall I thought it was a pretty solid game for you guys. So Be sure to leave me any questions you have or any videos you'd like to see in the comments.